Today's title is today's seminar title is Turbulence in Equilibrium, and my collaborators are here, Shashwat, Somdeep, and Aryan. They are all from ITK, but this also is an Indo-French project. So Frank is also involved in this project. But this work presently we are doing it locally, and Rodin is also trying to do something, and there's a whole eco-normal, Stephen Forbes, Brache, and Alexakis. So there's a paper which is in preprint, which is shown below, and it's unpublished right now. So let's just get started. So normally we think of turbulence as the out of equilibrium phenomena, you know. So that means, so I will explain what is out of equilibrium and what is equilibrium. In fact, these are a bit technical words. So let's take Kolmogorov theory of turbulence first. And through this, I will explain what is out of equilibrium. I mean, it's a bit technical, so I just want to be clear, clearly illustrate what it means. So this is a Navier-Stokes equation. Everybody knows about it, but some people who may not be very familiar, so I will just say that this is a Newton's law for velocity field. So P, velocity field U, P is pressure gradient. And we need a viscous term and the external force, okay, for Navier-Stokes. The external force could be stirring by a spoon of a coffee. And we assume in this talk at least that it is incompressible, but that's not really required. But okay, let's assume incompressibility for today's talk. So we need viscosity and external forcing for Kolmogorov theory. Now, there's a thing called Reynolds number, which is UL by nu. Viscosity, velocity field, length scale divided by viscosity. Okay, so this viscous coefficient is here, kinematic viscosity. Now, what does Kolmogorov theory says? That we supply energy at large scale. So just think of a coffee, and we are doing stirring with a spoon. So we're supplying energy at large scale, and then it cascades to small scale and small intermediate scale, and then finally to very micro scale where it gets dissipated. So the scale by scale transfer, and so this is a picture which I would like to say here. So we have external force here, which is supplying energy, then is cascading down to here, and then basically these are blue ellipses are vortices or eddies. And it goes to small scale, and then finally goes into particles, which heats the fluid, you know. So this part, this energy flowing from one unit of flow to another unit, you know. So basically, you can say there's a big bank, which is giving to money to smaller banks, or smaller. So there is a net transfer from one entity to another entity. So this is like there's a not balanced, this is not balanced, you know. So I give some, let's say, a richer guy gives money to, okay, sorry, this is, a richer guy gives money to the less rich guy. So these are energy transfer which happens, okay? And so finally it goes into particle heat. So this part, the blue region is called non-equilibrium, because there is a evolving, there's a net transfer from one region to another region. And in thermodynamics, so there's no net transfer of energy from one region to other region, right? Because molecules on the whole, one molecule will give some velocity to other molecule and vice versa. So there's no net energy transfer from one molecule to another molecule. And this is what happens to this stuff. Now, let's go to the next slide. So we have this energy cascade, energy flux, and is going from here. This is in Fourier space. So energy is going from pi uk, which is for radius k, and then goes to k plus dk. Okay, and so this is Kolmogorov theory, because we are supplying energy at large scale. Intermediate scales, there's no energy supply. So essentially, this is a conservation of energy, you know. So in this orange sphere, there's nothing coming in, nothing going out. Well, basically there's some well, I should not say that. I would say that no external force is pushing energy, and there's no dissipation, so fluxes remain constant for this yellow sphere as well as for the red sphere. Now, so these leads to, we can just do dimensional analysis and very easy to see that this leads to K minus 5/3 spectrum. So I'm sorry for people who are experts, but I just want to set it up. And so this is a spectrum. So this is an energy spectrum which comes from a simulation, and this is constant flux. Okay. Now, I hope this is clear that it is a non-equilibrium process, because energy flows from large scale to small scales, or intermediate scale and small scale. So the net transfer from one regime to another regime, this is in Fourier space, if you may call, or from one structure to another structure. So this is the non-equilibrium phenomena in this. Now, this is unfamiliar with me. So what is the equilibrium system? Contrast this with the equilibrium system now. So in equilibrium systems, we have thermodynamics as an example. So principle of detailed balance. So what is principle of detailed balance? Is that no region of real space or Fourier space gives a net energy to another region of Fourier space or real space. So flux will be zero because there is no net transfer from one region to other region. There is no multi-scale transfer like happens in turbulence. So essentially, in thermodynamics, you have single-scale phenomena. The molecules are giving energy to another molecule but getting it back after some time. Okay, so this is called principle of detailed balance, which works for equilibrium systems. So like people say, crude analogy is Marxist economy. You know, there is no net transfer. Supposedly everybody is in equilibrium. Everybody has equal wealth. You just exchange money and there's no net transfer, net transfer of wealth from one region to other region in idealist Marxist philosophy. Now, so time is kind of frozen in this. So I will not get into that, but there is also arrow of time connection with this one. Now, so let's look at connection with kinetic theory of gases. So just to make a connection which makes it, which is useful for this talk, so we can get some ideas. So basically there are n particles, and we embed this in velocity so there's a called mu space. So mu space is three components of velocity and three coordinates. So normally we think of real space for the flow, but here we have also six dimensional space. Other three are the momentum or velocity field. So distribution function, which gives you the probability of finding, number of particles at this position x, y, z, and having velocity ux, uy, uz. So this is a distribution function. Now there's an equation for distribution function called Vlasov equation or Boltzmann equation. So this tells us how f will change with time. Now, so under equilibrium, my u dot, which is the force, u dot will be zero. So the next line. And also there's no net velocity. So r dot and u dot will be approximately zero. And as f does not change with time, so df by dt is zero. So the change due to collision is zero. Now Boltzmann showed that df by dt collision is proportional to this distribution function after scattering, and f1 f2 are before scattering, okay, and this must be zero. And if this is zero, then one function which satisfies that f1 prime f2 prime equal to f1 f2 is this function. So this is some simple derivation which is given in any textbook, so it tells you that the distribution of velocity field is Gaussian. So mu squared by 2kBT, Boltzmann constant, and T is the temperature. Now, this is what the molecules in our, well, not in our room, because our room is in turbulence, but a fluid with very low temperature, where turbulence is negligible, this is supposed to be the velocity distribution. So this is called Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, and here it's a detailed balance. In the sense, I told again, I mean this may be 10th time I'm telling, that there's no net energy transfer from one molecule to other molecule. Now, very surprisingly, now does turbulence have an equilibrium regime? Okay. Now it turns out it does, and it does give you some very interesting insights. Now, but of course, in Navier-Stokes equation, we do not have. Well, there's some region which you can say that is some equilibrium. Like I said, the fluid which is getting heated, you know, at small scale, that is in quasi-equilibrium. They're heating at very small scale. But let's ignore that part and let's go to Euler equation, which is a specialized Navier-Stokes equation. So this work is starts from T.D. Lee, physicist who got the Nobel Prize, particle physicist, and Robert Kraken, 1973 and 1952. Now, these are Euler equation. Okay, so please note that the viscous term is turned off and there's no external forcing, so that those are off. So we have energy conservation in this. So there's velocity field and pressure gradient, and there's conservation of energy in this. So u squared will be constant if I integrate over the whole space, and the relative number is infinite. So when we say, well, this equation is like should be super turbulence, you know, a Reynolds number is infinite. But it turns out it has equilibrium behavior if you choose the initial condition properly. Okay, so this is what I will emphasize here. So so this is what we'll study. So let's look at again. I will try to contrast with what I discussed some time back. Kolmogorov turbulence, this is a Kolmogorov turbulence, you know, energy cascade from large scale LF to small scale, and there are particles here. And so this cascade and this constant flux. But what happens in Euler turbulence? So basically we can start with the equilibrium phenomena, or we can reach phenomena I'm going to show you in a minute. So this is the phenomena, this is expected, okay? This is what T.D. Lee and Robert Crichton said. So these are vortices, structures. Now these structures, you can see the arrows. The arrows are supposed to give, like they are indicating the energy transfer direction. So this blue structure and this blue structure, they're giving energy to each other. So there's no net energy transfer from any block to any block. And this is equilibrium, like what happens in gas. And the flux is zero because there's no net transfer from any scale to any scale. Flux is zero. So I'm telling you this is what we will get. We'll show in numerical simulation. And we did find, so details will follow in a minute, but this is a Euler simulation done by both Soundeep and Saswat. So this is a cross section of a 3D cut, so we get this different velocity field, you know, and this is a noise. It's like what we get in a fluid flow. Okay, now in gas. Now this is Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Of course, there's a V squared factor because the shell V squared, and this is noise, okay? Just like what we get in gas.
What is E? We have a PDF. What is E?
E is the energy.
Kinetic energy.
U squared, kinetic energy. So we are doing in real space. Huh? So we have Euler flow, and for any, basically, we look at velocity of the full flow, and we basically do the PDF of the velocity field. Okay,
what is the numerical method?
So I will come to that. So okay. I'm showing the result right now. Okay, so this real space. So this looks like, just to convince you that it is as random as a thermodynamic gas, right? I mean, this is what we, but this requires specialized initial condition and specialized simulations. Okay, so this is what we are going to go towards. But I was just telling the theory first, okay?
So the current was just homogeneous turbulence, right? Just isotropic homogeneous decaying turbulence.
Yes, yes. So it's a periodic box simulation, and yes, so there's no forcing, is periodic box.
Yeah, no viscosity and forcing, right?
Indeed, indeed. Okay. So this velocity field, so I'm just doing a bit of theory, okay? Very simple theory in this, and you can see why, what is expected on this, okay? Now, velocity field is, if it's totally random, uncorrelated velocity field, ui, uj, r is a position at same time, is delta correlated. Means, if you take two different points, the correlation is zero. If you take the same point, then correlation is non-zero. And this free factor is u squared, okay? So, I and j are supposed to be the components.
This comes from theory or any observations?
No, this is assuming the velocity field to be random.
Okay.
Yeah. Like thermodynamic gas or in Euler flow. Okay. So I'm just trying to build up what should be the spectrum and so on. Just building up some.
It's basically white noise, right? It's white
indeed,
noise.
Indeed, it's white noise. Indeed, indeed. So the velocity field in Euler flow or in a thermodynamic gas is supposed to be white noise. Now, if I do the Fourier transform, that is correlation function, Ck. You know, there's a modal energy. So this is a correlation function, and its Fourier transform will be the spectrum. Yes?
The random initial velocity field, will it satisfy continuity?
Yes, yes, it could. It is enforced. I will discuss a little bit later.
Okay.
What is independent? Yes, we impose this incompressible condition on this. It is imposed. Okay. Now, it's a Wiener-Kinchin theorem that Fourier transform of this correlation function gives you modal energy. And that is E by N. Total energy, this per mode. Every mode has equal energy. Unlike Kolmogorov theory, which says every mode has k minus 11/3. And shell spectrum is k minus 5/3. So they are different at different scales. Here, every mode has same energy. By the way, white noise, the Fourier transform is a flat.
So this implies that the largest modes also have some energy, right?
Everybody has the same energy for different k's. All k's have same energy. Okay, there's no large
mode. That is enforced, right? I mean, you are enforcing it. All the modes to have the same energy.
No, it's not the case. If we start with random initial condition, we get this as a steady state. It follows. It will follow.
Yeah, it's a delta function, and then the Fourier transform is a constant.
Precisely. So it's surprising, but it is maintained. It's not surprising. I mean, T.D. Lee had kind of, and Krekin had argued this. So it's not new, really. But it is, I mean, if you are only in Kolmogorov regime of turbulence, this will be surprising a bit. Now, for 3D, it will be k squared because you have to sum over all the modes in a shell. So that will be k squared. In 2D, it should be k because we are going to sum over a circle, you know, modes in a shell around a circle. And in 1D, it will be just constant. In fact, because there's no, so this is shell spectrum. Ek 3D shell spectrum is k squared, 2D is k, and 1D is constant.
So the top one, the modal energy statement applies only in 1D. That's what you mean, right?
No. It's all D, all dimensions. This modal energy is all dimensions. Every mode has same energy if the velocity field is white noise.
Okay. And right. The EK you obtain by convolution?
Just integrating over a shell.
Okay.
EK, this is a shell spectrum. I should have written that. This is a shell spectrum. This is a vector K and this is a scalar K. Okay. Now,
Mahendra, E of k is density, huh?
Yes, it's a shell spectrum.
So in fact, this formula comes only from dimensional analysis also.
No, actually, I'm right now showing that here constant. So in a sphere, you know, how do I get a 1D spectrum? So I sum up all the energy of the modes in a spherical shell. So
I understand, but you can, I mean, the dimensional analysis will not give you the figure 3 or figure 2 for figure in a
Where is figure
two? In 3D, you have a figure 3e divided by K max cube.
This is normalization. This is normalization. Please don't worry about. So this is energy by number of modes. You know that that is.
But dimensional analysis will give you directly the formula, except the figure 3.
Right.
It's like volume. It's like area in a in one dimensional, two dimensional, three dimensional. Area in 3D is R squared. In a cylinder, area is 2 pi R H. Right.
Yes.
Yes. Basically, it's a number of modes in a unit, which is a spherical shell here, is a circle here, and is a just a slab here. Okay.
Varma ji, this is Supratik. Just 1 minute. Hello.
Okay.
Yeah. So I wanted to just inform because there are two meetings tabulated there, and me with Abhishek Ranjan and Rajesh, we were waiting for the last 15 minutes on the next. The second meeting. And we just discovered that the meeting has already started long. I mean, just to...
Sorry. Can everybody come here? I'm sorry. This is I'm new to this.
I am just telling them. Okay. Just, yeah. Okay.
Tell them. Sorry. I think I... Okay, so a bit of problem here. So I think other people, so let me just apologize for, so apologies to people who are, I think I opened two calls and that was the problem. Okay, Abhishek and Supratik, are you in now?
Yes, I'm in now.
Okay, sorry. So basically just to summarize, I'm looking at equilibrium of, so I will just go back a few slides Kolmogorov-Thorey everybody knows. So I'm just basically doing a Euler flow, which is viscosity is off and the external force is off, and the Euler flow shows equilibrium behavior. Okay, so if I just go back to, so Euler flow is so this Euler equation where viscous term is off and forcing is off, and then this flow shows it is equilibrium. That is, no eddy gives a net energy to another eddy, and the flux is zero for this. And that is what we are studying. This is the flow profile of a simulation of Euler flow. You can see it's basically random. Vorticity field here is random, like a gas in thermodynamics, and this is a PDF of real space velocity, which is zero. Now we are trying to get to what happens to the Fourier space velocity field. Okay, and for random velocity, which we see in the earlier slide, it was delta function. You know, you expect gas in a thermodynamic system to be delta correlated, and that energy is energy of the mode by Fourier transform will be constant, and in 3D. 1D shell spectrum. This 1D shell spectrum is k squared, 2D is k, and 1D is a constant. Okay, and this is zero flux because this can be shown analytically as well, but by energy transfer formulas, but it has no flux. If it is white noise, there's zero flux. So this is equilibrium. Okay, now let's try to see how to get this, somebody asked, how to really get this in simulation. Incompressible condition is slightly tricky. So we want to go to Krea-Herring basis and employ a specific, specialized initial condition. Okay, so Krea-Herring basis is kind of simple. It's a Fourier space, so there's a spectral simulation which we will do. So these are 2D, okay? So this green line is, arrow is telling us wave number K. And so k dot uk is zero. So that means the velocity field must be perpendicular to the k vector. You know, so there's no component along e3 here in that direction. There could be some component along e2, but we are assuming only fully 2D flow. So the velocity component will only be along e1. So uk is u1k, e1k. And u1k I have to choose. So what we chose in our simulation is that u1k is amplitude is constant in the initial condition only, and phi 1k is random. So this not I, but phi 1k is random in 0 to 2 pi. So my this velocity field initial condition is, since phases are uncorrelated, randomly chosen for all the k vectors, then it is basically random.
I have a question here. You wrote the velocity is perpendicular to the wave number vector, right? Is this like a chosen like that or?
No, that is gray herring. Well, yes, we choose it so that I satisfy the incompressible condition. And I have one variable now, not two variables. And so we just do like this. But our simulation, of course, uses UX, UI. So there are conversions from U1 to UX, UI and vice versa. Okay. But initial condition, you start like this, convert it to UX, UI and start the simulation. Okay. Now, we choose a very specialized condition, time stepping scheme called PFERL. So this one is for Hamiltonian systems, so for Monte Carlo simulations, but we adopted it for this flow. This is basically conserves energy. Is time reversal symmetric? There are some fluctuations, but very tiny fluctuations. It conserves something like 10 power minus 5, 10 power minus 6 accuracy. So it's a pretty nice scheme, and I really recommend if you're using Euler flow or time conserving differential equation, use this. Like leapfrog is another method, but that doesn't conserve energy after some time. And it tries to explode. This one is also very stable. Okay. Now, I don't know much about the theory of this, but we just discovered it and it works. Okay. So that's what I will recommend. So this is a scheme which you use, and standard, we are running it with Python code. This is not implemented in Tarang right now, so it is running in Python code. Now, so these are spectrum for 2D. So we have energy, you can see so this normalized spectrum, EK. So it is, okay, I should have written this one, this slide was prepared in hurry. So EK is, EK is supposed to go as K, so I divide by K. So this EK divided by K, okay? So this is not really EK. I'm sorry about this. So it is normalized so that it's flat instead of showing it.
Does the simulation have any hyperviscosity or it is completely zero inviscosity?
Zero viscosity. Zero.
Okay.
So
thanks.
Energy is conserved, but it fluctuates 10 power minus 5 by 1.
So you solved the earlier equation.
Yes, we solved earlier equation. And the flux is constant, pi k is constant, okay? So this for this. Now in 3D, so this was for 2D. So 3D is a bit more complicated. So this is again called Krea-Herring basis. And Krea-Herring, these formulas were, Krea is 50-year-old formula. I mean, this is, she was in Grenoble, PhD student, I think, her thesis. So so this E2 and E1. So these are, so basically the K vector here, and there are two components. So velocity field will be in a plane formed by E2 and E1. E1 is coming perpendicular to it, which is not visible here, but is here, okay? It's E1 coming towards you right now. So so velocity field here is U1k, E1k plus U2k, E2k. So this is the velocity field. Now, for helical cases, so let's worry about right now helical case only. Sorry, not non-helical case. So we have zero kinetic helicity, which is U dot omega. So I want to make it very simple right now. The velocity field which I chose in a few slides back has zero helicity. There was no helicity in this. Kinetic helicity, U dot omega is zero for that. So that is achieved by setting U1 as 0. We choose only U2, this component along U2. So again, now it's very simple. We choose U2 as A times exponential I phi 2. A is constant in the initial condition, and phi 2 is random. And we just take random for all the modes, not same constant, but different random numbers. So the velocity field in the initial condition is random. Now, this is again normalized spectrum, so I should divide by k squared, EK by k squared, and that is almost flat except at a small k there is some increase. Now that is because for k equal to 1 there is no k at half, know, k equal to 1 is the largest Fourier, smallest Fourier mode, which is corresponds to AD of the box size. So basically, the asymmetry for low wave number modes, there is energy not flowing to the left. Energy is only, well, nothing is flowing to the left or right, but there's no mode to even take some energy to the left. So k less than 1. So I think that is the reason, which we don't fully understand, but we always get this. For low wave number, there is a bit of problem, but otherwise it's flat. So Ek by k squared, I made a typo here, Ek by k squared, and flux is again 0. You know, and this is ran up to something like T is 1080 turnover time, or even longer. The code just keeps going with this scheme.
I have one question, sir. So you impose periodic boundary conditions, right?
Yes.
So you can't expect any wave numbers to be present below k equal to 1, right?
Yes, precisely. That is probably the reason why this, I expect it to be k squared throughout. But we are not getting k squared for wave number from 1 to 10 or 1 to 9, okay? And why okay. So? That is what I'm trying to make a guess.
But the subharmonics, you can't expect subharmonics inside the flow with periodic boundary conditions.
I completely agree. And I'm trying to, I agree with you. And I just want to argue why we are getting deviation from equilibrium theory.
Okay.
Large K also, there's a bit of thing. That may be because of truncation. It again, at the end of the box. You know, there's the K-max, which is N by 2 or N by 3 by de-aliasing. So the large K also, there is a cutoff. So these are truncation errors of the box. So these people call in StatMech called finite size scaling. There's huge literature for it, and I think it's connected to that. But I don't know. I mean, I have not connected that part.
So now, this is a 3D simulation also, there was no viscosity or hyperviscosity.
No viscosity, no hyperviscosity, none.
What was the box size, 64 cube or what was it?
No, box size, this one 3D is 256 cube and 2D is 1000 square.
Why are you plotting the spectrum only until 48 or 50?
Okay, now this is probably at a lower grade. This is 128. This is 128 cube. This is 128 cube.
So this is 128 cube.
Something, yeah, is this 128.
128, you should go up to 64.
So KF is 1/3, right?
De-aliasing, which is 1/3.
So it's equivalent to 48 cube, basically.
So,
no, sorry, 96 cube.
So N by 2, N by 2 will be 64, and take 2/3 of that.
Okay. 48.
Okay. The complex.
Yeah. So that's 48, right?
Okay. Yes. So 48, we are basically cutting off some of these things here. It's going up to that. Yes. Now, so what's the big deal? So there were some simulations of Euler flow. So,
Mahendra, before you move on, I have a question. Kinetic theory, the classical Boltzmann, this Maxwell Boltzmann distribution assumes a continuum of E energy states, whereas in quantum mechanics we have fixed energy states. So there's an analogy with having you have k large scale modes which are sort of discrete. Can one think about it in that way?
I think for me, we are able to get thermodynamics from discrete case.
For large case, they will become almost like a continuum. But for the low K modes, you're not in the sort of, the density is, you can feel the density having discrete levels.
Yeah, I think there is a bit of, is Pratik, I presume. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah. Pratik, so this random noise, if you want to get a totally random noise, you need all wave numbers. It's a bit counterintuitive, but it follows from Wiener-Khinjian theorem. If you want a totally white noise, then all the modes must be present. For you may think that noise will require only the wave number of that particular scale of the noise. No, it's all the modes. So that is what is coming here as all the modes have energy, but they all of them have same energy.
No, I understand that. What I was just saying is that your EK versus K is not totally flat.
at low k's you have a little bit of deviation. Can it be because of the discreteness of k?
Yes, it is discreteness. I think it's called finite size scaling in StatMech. Yes. So box size is finite, that leads to that. Yes, indeed. I think that is connection is there.
Okay.
And that could be connected with quantum phenomena as well. I mean, there's possibility.
Yeah, so that's the idea. I agree.
Now, so there are a lot of work. I mean, there are hundreds of papers in Euler flow as well as superfluid turbulence. And also for other systems like Burgers flow and so on. So people have done this work, but they chose Taylor Green vortex is the initial condition. This is the initial condition, which is large scale structure is the initial condition. So this is work by Brasse. I mean, Brasse is a big leader in this field. So he has worked for several decades. And they chose Taylor Green vortex typically for almost all their work. And if you have a large scale initial condition large scale vortex, then what is going to happen? Energy will flow from large scale to smaller scales and keep going down. But viscosity is zero. So what happens? After some time, basically you can think of these large companies are playing, like there's a lot of trading going on, there's cascade, but at very small scales, there's equilibrium. So these modes at some point are, you can see my cursor, these modes are in equilibrium and these modes show k squared. So this phenomena has both non-equilibrium as well as equilibrium. Okay, and this is what they got. They do not get k squared for all the wave numbers, and we get k squared for all the wave numbers. So this is not really their simulation. I would say that it is not fully equilibrium simulation. It is combination of non-equilibrium and equilibrium. So that's the difference which we see in our simulations.
So are these different colors at different times so that you're starting to approach equilibrium as you wait longer and longer?
So later time is the last time in their simulation is that brown curve. Start with red and goes to brown and they stop here. Now, asymptotically, it's argued in the paper that if you wait for long enough time, all of them will become k squared, which I believe in. But it's impossible to go to that far with modern.
Basically, what you are doing is you're initializing an equilibrium, whereas they're initializing a non-equilibrium and they're seeing if equilibrium is reached at some case.
Precisely. So this is like approach to equilibrium and ours is in equilibrium. So that's a contrast. And both are useful results, but that's a difference which I wanted to contrast. Now, quickly.
So Mahendra, a question, maybe a comment actually, it's that in the previous plot that you showed, you know, if you do a high Reynolds number decaying turbulence simulation with DNS, but if you under-resolve it, the spectrum turns around.
Okay, I see.
So you start piling up energy at the high wave numbers. So I think I might have mentioned this before to you that you use this sort of k to the minus pi third, and then this turning up of the spectrum has been noticed in under-resolved calculations.
I see. So yes, I think there's some piling up and some sharing of energy among the unresolved modes.
That's because of the aliasing, right?
Yeah. So
No. Not because of aliasing, it's because of under resolution.
Okay. So, I mean, within the K-square region, you can't resolve it forever.
Because
right?
You're supposed, the energy doesn't dissipate, so it piles up at the high wave numbers.
That shows up in this resolved zone.
So, basically, if you put viscosity, then the energy should go exponentially and go to zero. But since energy is not dissipating, so there is a regime where there will be k squared. If you're not able to dissipate, then there's kind of share among themselves. Okay, so I didn't plot it here, but there's a expectation is that so in a viscous flow also we under resolve will k squared, then final dissipation here if there's enough dissipation is put in there. Okay, so I think I agree with you, Ravi. I mean, this under resolve will give you k squared. But I think the connection should be studied more carefully. I don't know that work has been done or not.
Yeah, I don't know when those under-resolved calculations, when the spectrum turns around, I don't know whether it is k-square or not. So I'm not sure it's k-square.
And also the flux could be studied in that region. We can do the flux. Okay. So let's go.
Ravi, I had a question. Is this related to bottleneck, you think?
No, bottleneck is different. Bottleneck is different.
But there also the spectrum changes, right?
No, bottleneck is, well, I will not deviate into bottleneck. I will do it after the talk. Because let me go a bit fast.
Okay.
So initial condition matters. They said that Taylor Green gives a different behavior compared to random flow. And a large scale vortex leads to combination of equilibrium and non-equilibrium. I'm not concluding yet. Huh? So this is just, so this call approach to equilibrium, and there's a lot of work by Frisch, Brasier's group, Kristalovich. So there are many, many names which I didn't put it here. Many things on superfluids, Verger's equation, and so on. But by the way, many of them do put hyperviscosity. Yeah? So zero viscosity is not really studied in great detail. So people want to cut off the energy, I mean, basically stabilize the code. So that is the difference which we found with this new scheme. And with trick, with a bit of trick, we can get conservation and so on. So I think that is something will be useful for the whole community. Now, the important question is probability distribution function of EK. Now, the modal energy, the EK or CK is a modal. When you say K vector, that means energy of the mode. Now, this is useful for helical flow. Well, anyway, this is an important formula. Right now, I showed is average energy of the mode. What we plotted right now, K squared for 3D, K for 2D, they are averaged over time. Or okay, so we just took a particular K mode, we average it out. But now I would like to see what is the distribution function of this. So some EK will be sometimes less. So I show you a bit of derivation is bit involved, but it's very simple from statistical physics. So let's denote that PI. So please focus on a particular K. And this energy will be different for at different times. EK will not be same. So what I want to say is I didn't put a plot here. Even though we start with constant amplitude for all of them, this amplitude changes with time. It's not that amplitude will remain same. And phase also change with time. So it's a dynamic process. It's not that it's like initial condition is frozen. They change with time. So energy of the mode will change with time. But sometimes it goes up, sometimes it goes too small. That is what happens. So now we're looking for what is the distribution of E plus K and E minus K. Now let's assume that this probability of finding the E plus K is E plus I. Well, what is plus minus? I'm sorry, I should have said. These are helical modes by Wallef. So Wallef said that if you have U1, basically Krea-Herring basis are two components, so U1 and U2. So you can choose that basis function, U1 and U2, or use U2 plus IU1 and U2 minus IU1. Okay? So this bit involved, but for 3D, we have to have two independent vectors, incompressible flows, not three, but two. And this combination, which is called helical basis. And so there are two of the energies for each of them, plus and minus. So we say, well, it can both E plus K and E minus K are random variables. And they can take many, many values. And what is the probability for getting a given value E plus I is PI. So that's the probability. Okay. Now, this is a canonical ensemble derivation in StatMech. You can just look at a standard book. So constraint I have to put. So this is called, under this constraint, how to optimize it is Lagrange multiplier. That's what we'll use. So sum of PIs will be 1. By the way, this is for a given K vector. Now, please remember this given K vector. And average energy of plus modes will be E plus K. And average energy of minus is E minus K. Okay. So these are constants, E minus K, E plus K. These are constant. But E plus K and E plus I and E minus I are random variables. Now, extremize this function, this entropy. I should put a minus sign here. I didn't put the minus sign here. And this is a conservation of probability, and this conservation of E plus and E minus. Okay. Now, if you extremize it, bit of algebra, derivative with PI, partial derivatives, we get this for probability for E plus and E minus random variable. And you can do the averaging. Average E plus K is constant. It is 1 by beta plus. And average E plus K is 1 by beta minus. And you do bit of more. So they are not, this could be different, huh? Because when you put in helicity, they are not same. E plus K and E minus are not same. If there's no helicity, kinetic helicity, u dot omega, then for, well, so just rephrase, zero helicity will have both equal. If they're not equal, then that means kinetic helicity is non-zero. And in terms of, now you can convert from here to there, okay? Now this is, I can share the notes with whoever is interested. So now we can also write these formulas in terms of energy and helicity. Hk is helicity, u dot omega, okay? So the PI for finding energy EI and helicity HKI is this. These were derived by Kraken, by some other formulas, but I thought by E plus E minus, this is quite nice. Now, so you expect the probability distribution to be exponential, but involving both EI and helicity, okay? This is, so if helicity was zero, then it's exponential like a Boltzmann distribution for canonical ensemble. No, the eta exponential minus beta E, that's for E power minus beta E, that's Boltzmann distribution. But helicity is another conserved quantity, so that comes in. So this grand canonical ensemble or some constraint gives you that. And energy as this formula, so the K dependence comes for energy. Energy is not constant anymore like what we saw for white noise. It has some K dependence here that depends on the helicity. If helicity was zero, then gamma will be zero. But helicity is not zero, then there is some K dependence. Then this is a derivation which I will skip. I just want to show that it can be shown that there is a K dependence in helicity. And this is a formula which Somdeep has derived. Well, not simulated. And Ek inverse. So we plot. So there's a, in the denominator, there is a K squared dependence. So we invert it. And this is that parabola. Okay. So beta squared minus gamma K squared is here. So there's again a deviation at low K and a large K. But in the middle part, it fits quite nicely with this equilibrium prediction. Now for 2D, the formula is reasonably simple.
Yes. I have a question. Isn't there a K square missing?
No, for EK, yes. And I'm sorry, yeah, there's a K square missing. So this has been divided by K, well, K square has come to the left. Yeah, so yes, there's K square missing, I agree. Yes. No. Yes, there's a K square missing for this one, yes. This should be EK, and there's a bit of typos, yes. So this should be K beta K squared here, and we normalize by this. So this is shell spectrum. Huh? This is, so if you go back, that was modal spectrum in the previous slide, this modal spectrum, and this slide is EK, which is a shell spectrum. So apologies for this bit of last minute slide preparation, okay? So I hope it is clear that it was flat, it was K squared without helicity, with helicity is going up, okay? Right now, I have not shown you what is the probability distribution. This is averaged. That means we do temporal average. We take this for different K vectors, we compute them, and we plot them, okay? So it's not flat with this helicity dependence. Now, this is for 2D. What is PDF? For 2D, I showed that PDF is exponential e to the power minus beta E. There's a bit of cheating here. There's a entropy also has some dependence, but that's small. So this is the PDF of EK for a given wave number K, okay? And that is exponentially falling. Now, this is from simulation. 2D, we could run it for longer time, 1,000 squared. And then we could get reasonably good fit to exponential, this PDF. For 3D, the work is going on. There is a bit of confusion here. I will report it in near future. We are working on 3D. Now, energy transfers. So this I will not detail it, but this what me, Frank, Rodion, we really like this topic. So we can compute energy transfer from mode to mode transfer. Like I told, no, there's a, we expect for detailed balance to work. That means nobody should give any energy to nobody. You know that. For 2D, the formula is this, which is from field theory. It's pretty complicated formula. This for different. So KPQ, we make a triangle, and these alpha, beta, gammas are internal angles. And it turns out we can show that this is zero for Euler flow. For non-Euler flow, this is a thing. Kolmogorov flow, this is what happens. Well, not Kolmogorov. In 2D, Kraken turbulence, But for we can show that this is this formula is zero for Euler flow. Euler flow, I have to put the constants for the CKs, and you can quite, I mean, this part is zero anyway, and this part is non-zero. So this can be shown to be going to zero. Now, moral of the story, so I'm concluding. So Euler turbulence shows equilibrium behavior, okay, for random initial condition. If you put non-random condition like big vortex, then it will be combination of non-equilibrium and equilibrium. And we have, it's analogous to thermodynamics. And this is where we reported our results. And before I close, I'll put a nice picture. Now, what does it say? So the river flowing into the ocean. Okay. Now, river is like non-equilibrium. Huh? River is flowing. There's energy flow. And ocean is happy. Ocean is content. Equilibrium. Equilibrium also means not noisy only. Huh? Equilibrium is meditating state. In equilibrium, in balance. So this is in balance. And this is flowing in. So Euler turbulence is supposed to be like ocean. And Kolmogorov turbulence is supposed to be like this. But in fact, the combination also exists. No? Like in real life, in real turbulence, the molecules in the gas or in water will be behaving like ocean. And this energy cascade from large scale going down to intermediate scale and small scale is flowing through water and finally dissipating, giving this to the molecules. Okay, so I will stop here. Thank you. Okay, so I guess I am done with my talk. So thank you is the last slide, but and this picture was nice. I just got it from Wikimedia. I hope I could, I mean, this, I thought I could connect this idea of equilibrium and non-equilibrium. Okay. So questions are welcome.
So does the simulations how you are done it through completely spectral method or pseudo spectral?
Yes. It's pseudo spectral.
So and how did you manage that the code doesn't blow up? Because in the plot you have both -π3 and then the k square profile, right? So at the end we expect like if you run the code for sufficiently long time it will eventually blow up because the higher modes keep on get generated and then they are usually under resolve.
To be honest, we have not done, so that simulation was Brassey simulation, 5/3 in k squared. We started our initial condition as as a random initial condition. Our initial condition, every mode has same energy. So we are kind of, we know the answer and we are pushing the system towards that answer.
Yeah, but like even if every mode has same energy, it's like the higher modes keep get generated, right? Like the higher modes are generated.
No. There is no cascade in this, right? There is no k to the minus. There is no cascade. So there's no energy transfer to the high wave numbers, correct?
Yes, correct. They basically...
So you're not running into a resolution problem anymore, I guess.
Yes, very correct.
How do you explain that the nonlinear term, like if you put two modes together, then it usually generates higher modes, right? How will they get killed or like what happens? Like,
so de-aliasing is taking care of that part and 2/3 rule. And there's nothing going outside by de-aliasing.
Okay, so the de-aliasing is the key here.
Yes. Yes, Ravi.
Quick question. So just basic Euler fluid mechanics, you're solving the Euler equations.
That's right.
You have these conserved quantities or constants of motion, right? They are Casimirs, right? So basically, entropy is a constant, and then you know higher powers of omega, like omega being the vorticity. Those are also preserved, right? Have you checked those in your simulations?
In 2D, yes.
Yes.
We not check that. We should check it. Yes. But our helicity is conserved for 3D, and entropy 2D we didn't focus on it, but entropy we could check how good it is conserved, and higher moments too. Yes, yes, useful too.
Okay, can you tell me about the helicity? What does it represent? What's the structure in that?
Helicity, you know, for is helical. Well, basically, so if you look at the velocity field, helical flows will be having some kind of screw-like behavior, and velocity field. Well, vorticity, so u dot omega, how to get u dot omega 0? For 2D flow, we have vorticity is perpendicular to the plane.
Right.
But now if you imagine that there is a uz, which is going like, there is a flow which is has vorticity as well as uz, so that vorticity and uz are in the same direction. So that leads to some kind of screw-like flow. So that kind of, so it's like a helical nature,
cyclotronic,
screw-like thing, or like in aerodynamics, people say elliptical. This elliptically polarized light, electric field goes there, and that is a
inter. So you would actually see that kind of structures in the flow field then.
Yeah, it is random. We didn't see that, but if you look at helical flows, large scale flows, I mean, for this flow, it is impossible. But if you have telegreen has zero helicity, but there are flows called ABC flow, where people see this this helical stuff. ABC flow, you can just look it up. There are a lot of literature in this, and they do see this this stuff. Like Frank has done a lot of that kind of dynamo work.
Okay, sure.
I have a question, Mahendra.
Yes.
So you showed the difference between Euler solutions of Euler equation and of Navier-Stokes equation.
Right.
In the Euler case, the flow is in equilibrium, and not in the Navier-Stokes case. So and the difference between both is due to the viscosity only.
Yes, yes, and forcing at large scale. I think the multi-scale is important for this, according to me. Not pure viscosity, but there should be scale separation. That is my like intuitive feeling, but. But go ahead.
If you start with the same forcing and add viscosity, then you will have some cascade.
Yes.
You agree with that. And so in some sense, you demonstrate that the arrow of time is due to the viscosity.
Yes, yes. I mean, well, arrow of time. So let me make this remark. If your question is done, so I will say the remark. One way to get arrow of time is by viscosity. There are other ways for Brassey simulation where there was no viscosity. Remember the Brassey simulation, phi third and k squared?
Yeah.
Also has arrow of time, but that arrow of time is because of a cascade. There's no zero viscosity, but there is a, so some region have arrow of time, some region has no arrow of time.
No, because if you wait sufficiently long, the k minus 5 third will disappear in the Brachet simulation.
Yes, and the time will be frozen. Yes, true. Yeah. But in there is the evolution of, so in the intermediate time, when there's a non-zero flux at large scales, there is arrow of time. Yeah. You know that it has to flow that way. So it's a bit tricky, yes, but viscosity plays a big role in real flows, at least for arrow of time. Which we discussed so far. I mean, so many times.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. So, I'm wondering if you have looked at kinetic energy consistent schemes or kinetic energy preserving schemes, because they really preserve the kinetic energy in discrete sense. So, and they do not blow up. I mean, like you said, for the spectral schemes.
Yes. So I'm as we. So our energy is, we keep our energy small. If you well, so. For configurations which we did, where energy is like 10 power minus 3 and so on, for the grids, 10 power minus 2. I mean, if you keep very large energy, then it may blow up. Also, initial condition, I think, is kind of random. So it goes on for long time. I mean, basically, we hardly see any blow up. But if you do simulations like telegreen, we are not guaranteed. We don't know. I mean, that part, we want to do it. There is some interesting questions to be asked in that thing, so we will not explore that. So I believe this is a good scheme, but will it work for all kind of cases? I don't know. It may not.
So I have another question, like in the Navier-Stokes simulations of Taylor Green, so you start with like counter-rotating vertices, and then you have like the scale separation and the smaller structures appear.
Yes.
So how would that in your Euler simulation, so you have like some number of structures and that will remain constant with time, or how does it multiply?
Our work, which is random initial condition, we see there is no structure. It's like a thermodynamic gas, velocity of thermodynamic gas. What we done. But there are other works, which I showed about Drasse's and colleagues, or I think Vishwanath also is probably in the audience, I'm not sure. They do simulation where they put Taylor Green vortex, and then they get structures which, but at small scale, there's the equilibrium. So that k squared part is equilibrium. So it's combination of non-equilibrium modes and equilibrium.
Okay.
So, but our case is all fully like random. We have no structures in our flow. Like I showed the picture, no? Basically dot dots for vortex. I mean, there's nothing.
Yes. Okay.
That is what we get. And that is maintained, no? That's like goes on and on.
Sure. Thank you.
Hello, MKB.
Yes.
Can I, this is Raja.
Yes.
So can I just ask a couple of queries? I mean, it's an extraordinary talk which has opened my eyes for the new field, how to really look at turbulence in different spectrum and other things, because I'm not into this kind of fields, first of all.
Yeah,
thank you very much for really opening up a new thing. I have really liked the talk, the way you made it like step-by-step kind of introduction to beginners.
Thanks a lot. Yes.
Now coming back to these queries, because I'm not into the field. That's the reason I'm asking a stupid question.
Go on.
For example, like in 2D turbulence, on Euler turbulence, what you are trying to solve, as initial condition, you have taken this random velocity field.
This that way.
Correlation is literally speaking, there is nothing like correlation length, there is nothing like any correlation except with itself.
Yes, yes.
Now, when you are trying to use this field, solve the equation, is stopping this uncorrelated field not to become correlated over the time.
Okay, now that's, there are...
For example...
Yeah, no, I understand.
If I'm just taking simple Burgess equation without viscosity, if I begin with any kind of random conditions, over the times it might develop shocks. There are some discontinuities and many kind of non-trivial things start to develop.
So I will answer this question. I asked this question for some time. So it's like in thermodynamics, if you start with all the particles uniformly distributed in the room,
okay.
Well, not in the room, room is turbulent, huh? So in a like low temperature gas,
okay.
Then will it separate? Now, answer is it will take huge amount, long time to separate. Same thing should happen here. So energy is distributed among all the modes in spectral, right?
But
this exponential e to the power minus beta e tells us what is the probability that one mode gets all the energy? We can compute it. And that number is very small. I mean, e to the power minus, well, I can just look at it. Is the time to get, but basically answer e to the power n. N is number of modes.
I see. But so is there any, but is there any direct connection or evidence between Euler's turbulence and the typical Maxwell-Boltzmann or Boltzmann transport equation in that sense?
So, from the output, we showed you that, this is numerical work, but you can see that it's just, they are one-to-one. I mean, I believe...
It happens in that way.
So, this we demonstrated that, by the way, I mean, our paper has been rejected like...
I just want to tell you, business is different thing.
It's an important work. They always see Taylor Green cascade, but I think it will require us some convincing that this is indeed. So I think there's some hand raised by Rodian. So Rodian, go on. So what do I do? So there's a raise hands. Should I click that?
His mic is off.
Okay.
Is my Microsoft, yeah.
Rodian, you can turn on the mic. STHE Rodian.
Yeah,
yeah. I think Fahad, you can, hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, now. But Rodian, after this, your mic was off. So, Fahad, first, then you. I mean, I think, please go on.
Sir, I have two questions. One, can you explain a little bit of about this arrow of time that I don't know about anything about? And secondly, sir, I wanted to ask that whether any type of structures evolve in this flow, if you are simulating for some times, any type of coherent structures or something like that.
So the second question I already answered with Raja, same question. So will a random flow lead to a structure? Like, for example, gas in a thermodynamic system, will it accumulate in some corner? Is unlikely, but it is possible. Hamiltonian system is called, you can look at Poincaré recurrence theorem. This is a Poincaré recurrence theorem. It's possible that you can get structures, but
I,
huge amount of time. And that is connected with this. I'm quite sure there is a connection. Yes.
Sorry to disturb.
I think Raja will come back to you. Otherwise,
we'll talk
short film. And the second question, arrow of time. Okay, it's a very... I mean, there's a full talk I gave, and of course, I think books have been written. But to summarize, the fundamental laws are, our Euler equation is time reversal symmetric. That means if you start with some initial condition, let the thing flow in one direction, in forward in time, you reach some time, then reverse the velocity field, and you'll reach the initial condition. You understand? So, like pendulum, you go from point A to point B, but you go from point B, you reverse the velocity field, you reach point A. So all the systems which conserve energy are show this behavior. Well, I mean, it has to, time reversal symmetric. You can show that T to minus T is a symmetric thing. But
so if you,
but in real life, you do not see that, right? I don't go younger. I always grow older.
Yeah.
Why is that? So this is called arrow of, I mean, the contradiction in arrow of time. Fundamental laws are symmetric, but our observation in the world around us is asymmetric.
Okay.
And I think, like what Frank said, viscosity is a big factor. Almost all systems have some dissipation, including quantum systems. And so that's one way to look at it. There are more subtle ways, like entropy increase. But I think friction is what I really like, which we worked on it. So for us, Navier-Stokes equation has arrow of time because there's a friction. Okay, friction will not make it symmetric. You go one way, so friction breaks the time reversal symmetry. Put friction, Navier-Stokes equation is not time reversal symmetric, but Euler flow is. Okay, now so I hope, but we can discuss it privately. I mean, this is a very topic which many of us have been thinking about it. But maybe I'll go to Rodian after that. Okay,
yes.
Rodian.
Yes. Thank you. Yes. Nice to see you, everybody, and thank you for the talk. I would like to clarify more your statement about initial conditions are meta. What do you mean exactly? Because everybody understood that exact solution depends on initial condition. This is obvious. But what exactly is meta in initial condition? Is it total energy helicity or the shape of the flow is important? And so what does it mean?
Okay, Rodian, I know that in chaos theory, initial condition is the first thing. So your output depends on initial condition. Here I meant the final state. So most of the work in Euler flow has been with Taylor Green vortex or large-scale vortex, ABC flow kind of thing. And that has led to both equilibrium and non-equilibrium configurations in the same system. Like Brassier's work, which I showed that thing, phi third and k squared. But so we were just kind of say, well, let's start with random initial condition to begin with. And we didn't get any phi third. We just get k squared for 3D. So that's what I meant. So we get complete equilibrium solution by starting with random initial condition and combination of phi third and k squared if you start with large scale structure. So that is my only remark considering the initial condition. Though initial condition is important in dynamical systems by many other angles. I hope it is clear.
Do you mean the final state? I mean, final equilibrium state will be different in sense of scaling, different for different initial condition.
Actually, for Brassey, that's not a final state. Final state, he claims he'll get k squared, which he didn't get because they didn't run it for long enough time, which they cannot run for. But final state, they say will reach k squared. You know, pi third, so k squared will reach there.
Yes,
k squared is the beginning itself. So that's their behavior and our behavior. Though asymptotically they will reach their k squared, which I also believe they will reach. But we get like this in the beginning itself. And very quickly get this equilibrium condition.
If I understand, the most difference between your solution and previous one, that with the random initial condition, you can impose the flow with a very high value of kinetic helicity. Because with the large scale flow, the helicity is always very small. It is limited by the energy multiplied by K. But for the case of random flow, if you impose energy at initial energy is present in the highest K, then it gives you opportunity to take the flow with the high helicity. And this is why you reach this state with K square. No?
No, K squared is for non-helical, zero helicity. The one with parabolic curve is for helical.
This is helical, but yes. this is my point, that with a random flow you have more the range of helicity which can be imposed is wider for the random flow than for the large scale flow. This is my
I guess so. I mean, I'm not I don't know this paper where you I know that you worked on this for shell model, but for us, I think we could inject our sigma c is 0.9. So the ratio of 2hk by ek is 0.9. So basically, it's pretty highly helical for the second run. We did two runs. One run was zero helicity, other one is 0.9. So, yes.
Mahendra, my question is, what is your opinion? I mean, what is your conclusion after your exercises? So if I would like to get the same scaling for the equilibrium state, what should be the same in initial condition and what can be arbitrary in initial condition? What is most important feature of initial condition to get the same or different equilibrium state?
To answer in a plain words, of course, everybody likes their own work, so we like our work. So if you're looking for equilibrium, start with random initial condition. So Krekenen 1973 or T.D. Lees, we should start with random initial rather than Telegreen. Now, if you are looking for
approach... Sorry, Mahendra, may I just... So does it mean that you have to take initial flow at smaller scale as possible? Is it true? Because what I understand, random initial condition, it means initially your energy is imposed is in the smallest available flow.
No, actually, it is tricky. No, it's not quite. You remember that we have constant energy for constant modal energy for all the wave numbers. So white noise can be obtained by not giving energy at small scales. White noise is obtained by giving energy at all scales with random phases. So that's an important point. So energy at all scales exists, but they are all random. So if you superpose them, like Wiener-Kinchin theorem, we superpose them, then you get white noise. That is what we get.
Mahendra, you know that there are many noises, white noise, brown noise, red noise. So are you sure that if I take red noise initial condition, then my result will be different, or it will be the same result?
No, it will be different.
Are you sure? Did you try it?
Well, we've not tried it, but that's...
Please try it for me. Take the red noise initial condition. I believe you will get the same. But you should take the total energy and helicity, initial helicity must be the same, but just different slope for initial condition. I believe it will be the same result. But okay, this would be interesting if you will check
after the, so I think we need to close the talk. I guess yes. There's no other question.